Okay. Sticky note. 13. Our purpose is not ours to achieve, but ours to be received, given by her graces and instruction. Death to the false fabricators of pleasure and indolence. The old order must be restored, the new order destroyed. True Templars dedicated to order and stability and peace, through the application of her iron will, and not through the dulling satisfactions of pleasure and indolence. I mean, come on! He was reborn, and Juno used him to her advantage over us to return to the world, but still failed for some reason I couldn't understand, really. She had not enough power, and she was too far-spreaded. Wild in the world wide web, I guess. So, what we are gonna do in this remaining time before the credits roll is, I want to find the sticky note.
And, well, what now?
Talk, you idiot! Look at the light!
Isn't that the battery? I think that's the battery. Hello? Hello? Sorry about this. My name is Sean, and back there is Rebecca, my partner in crime.
Hello.
Bloody good work earlier. Honestly, I mean it. Delivering us all that data. It's really just too bad that our man on the inside was such a, how to put it? Fanatic. Fanatic is the best word, I suppose.
We take who we can get.
Exactly, exactly. Well put. We saw in John an opportunity to burrow deeper into Abstergo's cloud servers, and I'm not ashamed to say we took it. Not realizing, of course, that he was enlisting you to help him. And to blame, should anything go wrong. I suppose it all worked out very nicely in the end. Most of it, anyway.
What Sean really wants to say is, if you're up for more hacking, we are too. John gave you level 3 security clearance before he died. You should use it. The assassins don't have the resources to pay you like the Templars do, but we'll make it worth your while.
Look, we should really cut it short, Bex. 20 seconds.
All right. Good luck.
Cheers, mate. And top-notch work. Really top-notch. Give yourself a pat on the back. And happy hacking.
Really? Yeah, of course. I do everything you say, and I start hacking right away. Because why the hell not? Okay, going here, going here, here, oop. I think at least that this is something I can go. What I need is to get here. Exactly. I guess. This is a little bit more complicated. Just a little bit. Cause I think I need the wormholes to get where I want to be, but I honestly don't know how to get there. A little help? Oh, god damn it. It's so sad that you can't help me right away. Come on. Oh, I hacked the other one so easily and so fast. Lightning fast. And this time I'm struggling so hard. And sucking so hard at it. Come on. Give me what I need. Yes! Okay. This is the final thing I do. Finding all the sticky notes from the fanatic. It's obvious that he put the notes everywhere. Oh. Okay. And hacking all the computers to get this inside. Unlock the secrets of our past, powered by Abstergo Industries Inc. Computing means mind reading possible. Abstergo Indu- Wow. This is, put it blindly. and it was 1.0. Oh, and there is, again, Assassin's Creed 3 footage, I guess? Wait, this is all? Okay, I guess we're hacking the next one then. Wait, this is my computer. I don't want to go there because I know the credits will most likely roll by... at this point. I have the feeling I already hacked the computers, but... maybe I was elevated? Wait. Why is it not... Is the computer not highlighted? There we go. And next one. Yeah, this looks cool, but it doesn't get me any closer to where I want to be. Is the thing where I can... maybe there some... where is my thing even? There we go. Oh! Maybe I should really just try to solve them. And then repeat the recording. Oh! There we go! Somehow I always stumble upon the solution. Try and error. And I'm a genius in mathematics. Don't you forget that.
Timestamp August 16th, 2013. The following audio clips were selected from over 160 hours of reel-to-reel tape found in the residence of the late Dr. Warren Vidic following his murder in December 2012. According to labels on the tape's canisters, these recordings were made over a 14-month period between 1980 and 1981 without the consent of their primary subject, Mrs. Eileen Bach, a colleague of Dr. Vidic's and the originator of Abstergo's surrogate initiative. Mrs. Bach is now deceased. It should be stated unequivocally that Dr. Vidic made these recordings illegally and of his own volition using wiretaps and hidden microphones. Abstergo Industries had no knowledge of his actions and disavows any responsibility for them.
And we're live. Capacitators at full. Ease the signal in. A little more. You feel anything?
Don't be timid. Double it.
No, we're taking it easy. 20%.
30.
Eileen, go easy. We're 6 past yesterday.
And boost the inputs.
Too risky.
Not if we split the I.O. signals.
25%. Ease up.
Oh, okay. There. I see something.
What is it?
Mein Gott. I hear talking.
You're okay?
Ja, ich höre Stimmen. It's German. Mein Name ist Miriam Kurz. I see a light. It's cold. Ich werde nichts sagen. There's a man with me. Mehr werde ich nicht sagen.
Keep an eye on our vitals.
Mein Name ist Miriam Kurz und ich bin eine Navajo. Des Hitlers Zwang, der macht uns klein. Noch liegen wir in Ketten. Doch einmal werden wir wieder frei. Wir werden die Ketten schon brechen.
Eileen?
Denn unsere Fäuste, die sind hart, ja. Und die Messer sitzen lose. Für die Freiheit der Jugend kämpfen Navajos.
Switch off!
Powering down.
Kämpft Navajos!
Get her out of here! Oxygen! Open the valve.
No. No, Satish, I'm fine, really.
Quit the heroics. Just breathe. Better?
Yes. Yes, thank you. Did we get something?
It'll take a while to pass. What did you see?
It wasn't just seeing. It was feeling. Being. I was scared.
You were shouting in German?
I think I was in Germany. I was in Germany, Satish.
Good morning. Well rested?
Exhausted. Yesterday was an incredible find.
Seems so. What did it feel like?
It's foggy, but I relived the memories of a young German woman. Early 20s, I think. A man was interrogating me, looming over me and asking questions. He was shouting, but I was shouting back. And then this poem just came out, like a chant.
Fascinating. I'm eager for you to hear the tape.
Is it ready?
Yes, we transliterated the data onto an audio file. It took all night to process the language.
Spool it up.
Of course. Have a seat. Judging by the subject matter and the setting, I'd say you landed somewhere in Germany in the 1940s, one or two generations back. During the war, I'd imagine.
1940s Germany? That would be Miriam Kurtz, my ex-husband's mother.
So she's not related to you in any way?
God, I hope not. I'd hate to find out my ex-husband is also my brother.
Well, if it was Miriam Kurtz, then we hit a home run. You tapped into someone else's bloodline entirely.
Should we celebrate?
We'll listen first.
Surrogate Initiative, Test Session 23, July 29th, 1980. Host, Eileen Bock. DNA sample, SB1970.
It's a little garbled at first. This is you settling into the memory.
Your name, say it.
My name is Miriam Kurtz.
Louder.
My name is Miriam Kurtz, and I am Navajon.
Where did you last see the artifact? Who holds it now?
I'll say nothing. I've told you all I will.
I don't believe that is true. Who has the artifact?
Hitler's dictates make us small, and you're bound in chains. But one day again, we shall walk tall. No binds will us restrain.
Enough!
For hard our fists, yes, and knives at our wrists, for you to be free. Navajos, lay siege!
Lock her away!
Navajos, lay siege!
And that's where we pull you out.
Whoa. What would it take to get a visual render of all that?
Months, unfortunately. It took 13 hours just to process the audio. Visual takes much longer.
But Vidic is able to record audio and visual in real time. How does he do it?
His subjects are exploring their own genetic memories. That requires much less processing power.
Hold on, sorry. Eileen here.
Hello. You have 10 o'clock in Lillian's office. It's 10:13 now.
Oh, shit. I'm sorry. Tell her I'll be right there. And tell her we have some good news.
No problem.
You in trouble?
Ugh, the monthly progress report. I'm trying to be honest about our progress, but no matter how much I polish our facts, Warren Vidic swoops in, promising the moon for pennies, and gets 10 times the funding for his Animus project.
Well, we are using his Animus technology. He's the foundation. We are the skyscraper.
Which is why he should be a tech lead, not a project director. Good work, Satish.
It's incredible footage, really. Clear and vivid. And the subject was synced for a full 62 minutes. Came out speaking French after his last session. Passably fluent. And with full recall of everything he'd gone through.
Sorry I'm late. I was reviewing some data.
It's fine. Warren was just telling me about his first subject. Mr...
No names. Call him Subject One. Confidentiality.
And how about you, Eileen? What's your good news?
Well, we did it. We synced with an unembedded memory outside the bloodline. That's a first.
Really?
Satish was able to process the audio today. A short clip. You can hear it for yourself.
Only audio? No real-time memory feeds like Vidic has?
Well, that's the difficulty with surrogate genetic memory data. Because I'm viewing memories not embedded in my own DNA, we can't rely on my cognitive faculties to help me process the signal. All we can do is record the raw data and transliterate it later.
Hold on. You're running this experiment on yourself?
I am. It's going well.
I don't like the sound of that.
Look, the sample I'm using, the DNA comes from my own son. It's safer this way.
Ah, good thinking.
50% of my son's DNA is also mine, which reduces the danger by a huge margin. Meaning, I can now explore the memories of people who aren't directly related to me, on his father's side.
But for brief periods of time, I imagine.
Right. Just a minute or two, so far. But we're getting there. Come by the lab and listen for yourself.
I will, when I have a moment. Unfortunately, work beckons. Ladies.
That man is colder than a San Francisco summer.
Stay focused, Eileen. You both have important work to do.
Obviously. But my work requires his animus technology. I feel a little caged in.
That's collaboration, Eileen. It's how science works. I shouldn't have to remind you.
I know. I'm just tired. Stop by and see us today. We have a lot to share.
If not today, then this week sometime.
Thank you.
Okay, this was interesting. It was something out of... Yeah, out of Germany! Yeah, my home country! Okay, this... I don't know on how many levels this was weird to me. Okay, it's always weird to hear your own country or language involved in anything inside a game. Especially if you play the game in English the whole time and then suddenly you hear German voices. Okay, you are my next victim. Whoops. This one was not intended. Yes, there we go. I like this animation in this little mini game. It's not too complicated and still as fun to do. Oh, Mama says Count Rosenberg will take care of us now. So long as Papa and Uncle John work for him, our home is big, but t.bone is a small town. Mama seems happy. Elizabeth Jane Watson. Uncle John, everyone else calls him Dr. D, says that not all 5 years olds can speak 3 languages or write as well as I do. I foretell a bright future for you, Lady Beth. Okay, this name rings a bell. I like reading, drawing, and writing poems, but mathematics are hard. John Francis, my brother, is better at calculations than I am. He's 1 year older. Papa wants me to get the same opportunities as my brother. He says I am fortunate that not all young ladies have private tutors. I study hard to please him.
We are fasting this evening, Master Kelly.
Uncle John announces. Papa grins.
Wait, Uncle John announces.
Papa grins. I know what this means. They will be working all night again. After dinner, I run to the parlor and jump on Uncle John's lap. His beard, unlike Papa's, is all white and rough. I ask him to tell a story. Uncle John makes everyone laugh. Even Papa, who's usually so serious. He says they have to work now. Mama tells me it is time for bed. I pull the sheets over my head and listen to the low, humming voices coming from the study. I'm afraid of the dark, but not tonight. Not with Papa and Uncle John praying. What's this image? Honesty. Papa needs to leave now to earn money. I know about money. We need it to eat and purchase things. I do not want him to go. I give Papa a big hug, and Uncle John too. I wave at them until I can no longer see their carriage. How long will they be gone this time? I ask Mama about Papa's work. She says he gives conferences with Uncle John, providing advice to people who need it. John Francis says Papa communicates with angels. I laugh, but Mama does not. He told me, he says, crossing his skinny arms over his chest. After a long pause, Mama sighs. John Francis is right. Your father speaks with angels. He gains.
She scratches her head. Insight from them. With angels! Oh, angels! Not angels, but angels! He gains insight. What? I ask Mama what an angel is. She says it is a being from beyond, a winged entity that lives with God in heaven. I do not know what that means. John Francis says only Papa can call angels. Mama nods, saying he has a rare gift. He uses a crystal ball, John Francis declares. Oh. I seldom see Papa and Uncle John these days. They do not eat. They are fasting again and spend most of their time in the study. I wake up with a start and pull the blankets to my chin. It is still dark, but I hear voices downstairs. Taking a deep breath, I sneak out of the bed. I walk down the stairs, avoiding the creaking ones. I fear monsters will jump out of shadows, though. Uncle John assured me he banished all monsters from our home. I tiptoe to the door of the study and put my ear upon it. I recognize Papa's and Uncle John's voice, but there's also another, much deeper voice within. A loud click. They have unlocked the door. I hide behind the cabinet. Papa and Uncle John come out of the study and walk away, smiling. I count to 100, then tiptoe toward the study. No one in sight.
Elizabeth?
Papa says behind me. What are you doing? Papa makes me promise not to go into this study. To his study. There are things in there you should not see. There are 100 questions I want to ask him, but I can only nod. I think it's one of the crystal skulls, or something like that. I've never seen Papa and Uncle so happy. They whisper and laugh at things only they understand. Mama says it is because they have done good work. I have finished my dinner and asked to be excused. Mama nods, and I hurry upstairs. I notice that the door to Uncle John's room is ajar. I hurry to the door, holding my breath. I peek inside. The room is sumptuous. Uncle John always says Aunt Jane has good taste, and he's right. I tiptoe inside and open Uncle John's armoire. It is filled with treasure. Shiny walks, a black mirror, a wax seal with pictures on it, a gold amulet. Ignoring everything else, I pick up what looks like a globe, packed in cloth. Could it be the crystal ball John Francis mentioned? Quickly I unwrap it. The sphere is heavy and feels warm in my hands. It is made of the shiniest gold. On its surface, I see a reflection of my face. And Uncle John's! Uncle John grabs the sphere and puts it inside his doublet. I shiver, but he smiles.
You should not be playing with things you cannot comprehend, Lady Beth.
Demons. We have been in Trebon almost 2 years now. We are happy here, happier than we have ever been. Papa continues to work while Uncle John is away. He keeps to himself and barely addresses us during breakfast. But at least he's eating now. I am feeble today. Mama says I have a fever and tells me to stay in bed. I sleep all day, and most of the night I awake famished. I dislike the night, but I am not as afraid of it as I used to be. I get out of bed, careful not to make a sound. I do not want to wake anybody up. A pale light emanates from the study. The door is open. Papa never leaves the door of his study open. I creep toward the light, on the tip of my toes. I sneak a peek inside. Papa leans over a table, reading a book. It has an odd silvery tint. Papa suddenly mumbles an incomprehensible string of words and numbers. Papa sprinkles red powder on something upon the table. I did it! His wide grin deforms his face. I did it! He picks up a clump of gold. Papa guffaws make me shiver. His voice is deep and he speaks words I do not understand. I hurry upstairs and crawl back into bed.
These are some nice pictures. I notice Papa and Uncle John in the distance. I pick up my dolls and hide behind the tallest oak in the garden. I try not to laugh as they walk toward me. Papa tells Uncle John that they should change the nature of their work, that they should study alchemy and stop wasting their time with angels. They pass by the oak. The book has boundless potential, Papa says. I need your help to unlock its formulas. I poke my head out. Uncle John frowns. We could work at the Imperial Court, Papa continues. Producing gold is only the first step. Uncle John turns to face him. I hide again, hugging my dolls. You should not fiddle with this book, Kelly. I almost fail to recognize Uncle John's voice. Cannot imagine the evil it contains. It holds more than mere numbers. Papa protests, but Uncle John interrupts. Your associate, Master Husey, the one who gave you the book. I dealt with him before, long ago. He cannot be trusted. Papa says they could be witched beyond their wildest dreams. I take a quick glance. Uncle John shakes his hand. No, my friend. The book will destroy you.
Okay.
Lust. Mama is in her room crying. She has barely uttered two words in days, and I suspect she has not even spoken to Papa. She has been avoiding his gaze. I'm reading when a loud clang makes me jump. Is John Francis acting up again? He can be such a baby sometimes. Another clash, followed by a shriek. A woman's shriek. Put my book down and hurry to the door. Papa and Uncle John are screaming at each other. I walk out of my bedroom. The shouting has stopped, but I hear sobbing now, coming from Uncle John's room. Is Aunt Jane hurt? The door of Uncle John's room suddenly bursts open. Aunt Jane cries out after her husband, but someone interrupts her. Papa. I feel the entire floor shudder as Uncle John slams the door shut. He glares at me, fire in his eyes. I am paralyzed. My eyes swell up. Uncle John takes my hand and pulls me away. You should not be here. He drags me downstairs. You should not have seen this.
What happened?
Papa and Uncle John seldom speak now. When they do, they shout, which makes Mama cry. Aunt Jane stays in her room. I wish I could do the same. I wake up jumping. Papa is screaming again. I close my eyes, wishing things would be as they used to. But I am old enough to know better. A door slams. I look out the window and see Papa walking towards the stables, shouting, "Envious fool!" I watch him disappear in the darkness. I run downstairs. Mama sits in the parlor, sobbing in silence. I crawl under the sofa. It is time for me to leave.
It is time for me to leave. Uncle John's voice is filled with sorrow. You will be missed, both of you.
Wishing Uncle John good fortune, Mama leaves. I stay hidden and watch Uncle John pace the room. I quietly follow Uncle John to Papa's study, producing a key. He looks over his shoulder and unlocks the door.
At life's end, you will understand, old friend.
Uncle John comes out of the study with Papa's strange silver book.
I'm doing this for your father. The secrets it holds are not meant for him.
Mama says she feels at home in Prague, but I do not. Papa will not let me do anything. He tells me the streets are not safe.
This is a long thing. Look, I'm only halfway through.
I like it when Papa brings me to Prague Castle. It gives me a chance to escape from the house and spend time with him. He's seldom home these days. People from all over the world gather here, at the center of European culture, as Papa puts it. I wonder why important people frown so much. Papa speaks with an elderly gentleman. His flowing white beard reminds me of Uncle John's. I sigh and take Papa's hand. He does not seem to notice.
We do not dare walk the streets, the old gentleman complains. Even during daytime, Papa nods, saying the park has never been so unsafe. You know why, Master Kelly? The Emperor. He leans close to Papa's ear. He's weak. He gives the people too much freedom. I heard that a killer wants amok targeting noblemen and alchemists. There's a tremor in the old man's voice. They say he's a monster. Giant. Some say he's not even human, Papa declares. I squeeze his hand, wishing Uncle John could be here to banish the monsters of Puak. Toil. For my 10th birthday, Papa will show me his workshop. I will finally have a chance to see where he spends his days, and many of his nights. Most people we encounter ignore me as I follow Papa through the corridors of Puak Castle, but some scowl or roll their eyes when they see me. The windows in this part of the castle have been sealed off with bricks and mortar. Papa carefully locks every door we pass through. Papa's workshop is a treasure trove. There is a myriad of items here, each more wondrous than the next. Colored powders, ancient scrolls, amulets. Papa works all day, reading formulas, mixing powers, boiling liquids. I watch from afar, afraid to disturb him. His work is so important. Papa constantly mutters to himself. He blinks a lot and often glances over his shoulder. He makes me nervous, especially when he barks strange words. "Cannot do it!" Howling, Papa throws a glass beaker to the floor. It explodes in 1,000 tiny shards. I cover my face. "I need the book!" Okay. Alchemists. Night has fallen when a young visitor interrupts Papa's work. He enters the workshop and announces that the Emperor has summoned his alchemists. Papa tells me to wait and warns me not to touch a thing. Then frowning, he takes my hand and drags me along. "You must remain quiet." We enter a dark room where a score of old men gather around a long table. Papa motions me to stay behind with the assistants and apprentices. A large man is in black cloth. With white ruff and fur head enters. Everyone bows. I take a step back, hiding behind a lanky youth. The man, the Emperor, sits at the end of the table, scrutinizing everyone in the room. When he raises an eyebrow, one of the alchemists jumps to his feet. "My brother has seen the monster!" The man squeaks like a mouse. "It is wholly black! A demon!" The alchemists discuss at length. Many alchemists agree this killer, this monster, cannot be human. "What if it is a homunculus?" Papa suggests. A deathly silence falls upon the room. "A homunculus is an artificial created human being, if you don't know that. Just in case. Or something like a golem. Yeah." "Well, there's a distinct difference between a golem and a homunculus, and I only know this because I watched Fullmetal Alchemist, a great anime by the way. You should watch it, it's a really, really interesting one." We leave Puak Castle before dawn. A score of guards escort us, and other alchemists. "For our safety, why are there so many monsters in the world?" Dawn creeps over the Vladtava. Finally, we arrive at the house of the last alchemist. We will soon be home. No, Papa will not stop talking to him. I walk into the alley next to the man's house. Two steps into and ouch! I bump into an invisible wall. White eyes appear in the darkness. I see it! The silhouette of a giant. Marks cover the monster's pitch black forehead. No letters. Emmet! I stare at the white eyes. "What are you?"
"I have been called many names." The monster's voice is strange, guttural. "Here they call me Golem."
Papa shouts, "Guards! Run towards us!"
"You have just saved your father's life, little one," it rasps.
Golem runs towards the river. I see it clearly now. A gigantic body, black and sinewy. The monster jumps in the river. I follow Papa and the guards behind me.
I observe the water, perfectly still, not a hint of a golem. We have never discussed Papa's imprisonment, not one word about it in over 3 years. Now that John Francis is away, I alone must care for Mama. Papa will be released from prison today, but Mama's worries. She says he has one last chance to satisfy the Emperor's expectations. Standing in front of the house, I hold Mama's hand. My heart beats quickly as I behold Papa's carriage. I forget to breathe when it stops, 2 paces before us. Mama trembles when the carriage door opens. A pale, emaciated man with long grizzled beard, steps out. Papa! He walks by us, as if we were ghosts. Mama has prepared roasted lamb, Papa's favorite, to celebrate his return, but he does not eat. He simply stares at his plate, silent. Mama makes idle conversation, pretending without much success that nothing is wrong. Papa suddenly stands up. His chair hits the floor with a loud thud. Papa storms out of the dining room, pushing invisible spirits out of his way. He shouts in a strange tongue, the same language I once heard him speak when I was little. My heart is in a knot, but I hold back my tears. I take Mama's hand, but nothing I can do or say will ease her sorrow. What will we do now? Failure. The Emperor has restored Papa's status, but soldiers guard our house. They are not here to protect us, but to make sure Papa does not leave Prague. A month has passed since Papa's return. He remains distant, but at least he does not completely ignore us. He works ceaselessly. Ceaselessly? I walk through the open doorway of Papa's study, the platter Mama has prepared for him in my hands, and stop. Papa sits on the floor and begins to howl. Ooh! I drop the platter and its contents spatters across the room. I want to Papa kneel next to him. He grasps my hand and immediately falls silent. Papa nails dig into the flesh of my hand. I bite my lip to suppress a cry. He suddenly raises a tight fist in front of my face. Close my eyes. I cannot do it. Papa's voice is bleak, desperate. Desperate. Not enough. Not even a handful left. I look at him. Tears run down his ashen face. Slowly, as if revealing a priceless treasure, he opens his fist in the palm of his wrinkled hand. It's a tiny bit of wet dust. Curse you, D. Papa works without rest, even though he keeps saying he has already failed us. He has not slept in weeks, and he barely eats. He's but a shell of the man I once knew. Papa shakes me out of my dreams. Elizabeth, soldiers are coming. I do not react immediately, for I am used to soldiers guarding our house. I look outside. There's a column of young men in uniform in our yard. Their torches cast dancing shadows upon their faces. Monsters of Prague. I open the front door. An officer and 6 stern-faced men step inside. The officer clears his throat. By order of... No! Mama darts forward, tears streaming down her cheeks. I hold her back. You cannot take him away! You cannot! Not again! The soldier eyes widen. Papa walks towards us, his face twisted in a demonic grimace. He murmurs a prayer in the strange tongue only he seems to understand. The officer tries to reason with Papa. Howling, Papa jumps on him, clawing at his face. A soldier strikes his head and he falls. Mama wails as they take him away. I'm 16 years old, and some of the guards in Hinnivan Castle have taken an interest in me. They insist on making conversations every time I visit Papa. None of them interest me. Most are boorish cretins. Others are more bedraggled than hawks in mud-filled sties. But I always smile and remain courteous. I take a deep breath when in the distance. I spot Hinnivan's tower.
I try not to think of the babbling louse. I will have to confront before seeing Papa. What is this? A cross off at the top of the tower? I'll walk more briskly. Then my heart stops. Papa! He stands on the edge of the tower, arms wide open. I run towards the castle. I see Papa clearly now. A skeleton in tattered robes. He stares at me. No, not at me, but beyond.
You have come!
Free me, divine messenger, free me! Papa raises his hands to the sky, as if praying. Heavenly guardian, guide my fall. He jumps off the tower. A leap of faith? I support Papa's broken body. He bleeds profusely, but holds my gaze. His demons no longer haunt him. D was wise. He exhales his last breath. Divinities. News of Queen Elizabeth's death reaches Prague. The Virgin... Is this really Prague? The Virgin Queen, after which I have been named, has passed away 1 month after my wedding. Oh, that's why I realized the name. Elizabeth Jane Weston. Oh, she's grown to be a beautiful woman. A knock at the door disturbs my thoughts. I lift my head from the blank page on my desk and put my quill down. Come in. Johannes, my husband, steps into my study. A tussock of raven hair brushes his face as he lowers his head. How remarkably formal of him. He apologizes for disturbing me while I work. I frown, feigning annoyance, but fail to suppress a thin smile. I seem incapable of writing today. Johannes' face lights up. His thumb as absently caresses the ivory handle of his cane. A package has arrived. It is addressed to Lady Beth. Lady Beth? Only Uncle John calls me thus. I have not heard from him in years. I run out of the room and hurry down the stairs, as I used to when I was little. Ignoring the letter accompanying the package, I quickly peel off the layers of cloth covering what I assume to be a framed painting. The painting depicts the Virgin Queen, two ladies in waiting behind her, standing in front of three goddesses. How thoughtful of Uncle John!
Why?
Three goddesses. Johannes and I stare at the painting, mesmerized. Magnificent! My eyes then fixate on the verse engraved upon its frame. Johannes contemplates every last detail, every tiny stroke, every subtle hue. Master Johannes Leo, husband, jurist, and connoisseur. See what lies on the ground? Johannes points a finger, first at a golden scepter, then at a quiver of arrows, and finally at fallen roses.
Juno, Minerva, and Venus! Johannes shakes his head, laughing quietly. He had not expected me to answer. He should know better.
Those are the three women who talked to me. Or Hera, Athena, and Aphrodite. Johannes' nose is 2 inches from the painting. The three goddesses whose beauty Paris judged. I remember the story well, having read it several times. This painting is an allegory, my husband says. I suspect otherwise, but do not contradict him. There's something familiar about the painting. Is this? Yes, the golden orb, identical to the one I found in Uncle John's room when I was a child. The Apple of Eden? Is this another Apple of Eden? It has to be. Fairy Queen, I sit in my study alone, staring at the painting Uncle John has given me. My hands tremble as my fingers brush the edge of the dry wax sealing a scroll. I carefully break the scroll's seal and unroll it. I immediately recognize Uncle John's penmanship. Lady Beth, it begins. I smile, for I am still fond of the private name Uncle John used to address me. Fairest and most noble of poetesses. Please accept this humble gift from your not-so-humble friend and mentor. Uncle John is much more than that. He's family, a second father to me. I hope you will find it a fitting tribute for your betrothal. I laugh quietly. I had never expected to receive such a splendid gift. If you observe the composition, you will surely recognize the trinket you once unearthed in my chambers. The golden orb. I knew it. You may think this picture is a riddle, an allegory, an artist's fancy. It is not. The object in the hand of the fairy queen is real. So is its power, and so are the goddesses. Data stream terminated. Okay, I have to ease a pain in my little stomach, and yeah, I will be right back to you.
And I'm back, even though it's pretty late right now. And there are a lot of computers left. I don't even know how many computers I have right now, but I think it's about 10 that I still need to hack. Oh, her computer is now available. Oh, come on. There we go. The secretary's computer. Oh, this is easier. This is easier than the ball thing. What am I talking about? This is harder. This is worse. Huh? Oh no! You see the red lines above and under? Oh, I have to come through here in one go. What? Oh, am I that tired that I can't? What? What? Huh? I don't get it. What's wrong? Shit, come. Okay, now I go from the lowest to the highest, and fuck, this is hard. This is not fun. I have to freaking double jump. I have to, oh fuck, no. On. Don't do this! I did it! Oh god! This is horribly hard! Oh god, and I even failed at the easy ones!
Our initial reports gave us hope that Enzio Auditore would serve as an ideal candidate for future Abstergo projects. His charisma, sexual magnetism, and wry humor gave him all the qualities of a leading man. However, his corruption by the Assassin Order robbed him of these qualities as he fell deeper and deeper into a spiral of revenge. Enzio was frequently known to articulate a passive acceptance of evil. He was also a man of ugly contradictions, one who preached free thought yet traveled well beyond his home country to proselytize his corrupted creed, just as he's doing here with this impressionable Chinese girl. Notice, too, that in his gestures and bearing there is still something of the old lecher in him. Enzio's entire personality is built around pure demagoguery, claiming his philosophy is about love when violence and coercion are his primary means of tackling problems. We have therefore come to the conclusion that Enzio Auditore da Firenze would be a risky character to develop.
Ezio Auditore da Firenze, please! Ezio, how can you mispronounce the name so hard? You should fire this man for mispronouncing his name and for being so... Really? I think this was totally intentional. I hope for the voice actor that this mispronouncing was intentional. That this was intentional to enrage the fans of Ezio Auditore. What's this? Server? Well, before we go to the server, we go to the computer. 22, so only 11 more to go. Oh god, I didn't thought I would do this in the end thing, but I want to do this right now. I don't know why. Maybe because I want to end this game so I can head on to Unity. And on the other hand, I don't even know.
Okay, so... they are getting harder, though. The puzzles are not as easy as they were before.
Okay, never mind then.
I like the audio files more, though, than the log files, because I have to read so much then.
Surrogate Initiative, Test Session 32, January 11th, 1981. Host Eileen Bock, DNA sample SB1970.
Miriam? Miriam, is that you? Are you in here?
Bartle!
Oh, thank God you're safe. You've been very sick.
Bartle, how did they find you? Oh, Jesus, what would they do to you?
Has they hurt you at all?
I told them nothing. All they do every day is ask about you and that artifact. But I didn't tell them anything. Nothing.
I know you didn't, Miriam. But how are you? You aren't hurt?
Not badly, no. I'm fine.
Good. We need to get the message out to Oscar. Somehow we need to tell him where...
Very interesting footage, Eileen. This is Germany, you said. World War II?
Most of the memories I've been able to access come from a period where Miriam was imprisoned by Nazis in Cologne.
Miriam. Is she still alive?
No, she was my husband's... my ex-husband's mother. She passed away about 5 years ago.
Well, she was spirited. An impressive lady.
Definitely.
And the man, Bartle. He made reference to an artifact. Any idea what that is?
My team is looking into that, but it's not our first priority. We still need...
It is now.
Really?
You must have other recordings of this woman. Are there any other mentions of this artifact I should know about?
Half a dozen or so, yes. What's this about?
You have questions, I understand that. I don't have answers for you. Not right now, but I do have money. And if you get me those recordings and bring me any other artifact references you find, then I will triple your operating budget for as long as I can.
Triple my budget? My God, what is this?
9 a.m. Monday morning, my office. We have a lot to discuss.
But Lillian, I don't...
Have a good weekend, Mrs. Bock. Fantastic work.
Really?
Hello, this is Carl.
Hi, it's Eileen.
Hey, how are you?
Good. Busy, cold. The winter's been terrible.
Seamus won't like that. The weather's been mild out here.
Well, he's only coming for a month. He'll live. And I'll be so busy, he won't have to worry about his mother bothering him.
Still working 12-hour days?
I should move a bed into my lab.
Look, if you're too busy, Seamus can stay with me.
No, I want to see him. We'll have fun.
You're not too busy to be a mom and a genius.
Of course not.
His flight lands at 8:15 p.m. tomorrow night. You'll be there?
Of course, 8:15.
P.M. Let him know you'll be there.
Thanks, Carl. I need to run. I'm sorry. Take care.
You too.
Oh, that's a bad habit to prioritize.
Ah, Eileen. Didn't see you come in.
I'm not interrupting?
No, it's fine. The subject is unconscious. He's traipsing around 18th century New Orleans right now, in the memories of a woman.
That must feel odd. How long has he been under?
83 minutes.
Whoa.
It's average. What can I do for you?
I just wanted to thank you for sending Lillian to see me. She came away very impressed.
There. You see, all these bureaucrats need is a little glimpse of our secrets every so often. They like to feel like they're still in charge.
Lillian is most definitely in charge. She just tripled my budget.
Tripled? Christ, Eileen. You must have discovered who killed Kennedy.
Well, she heard something on one of my tapes that interested her. Something about an artifact. Very vague. But it was enough.
An artifact? What sort of artifact? Jesus, get him out of there! Get him out!
Oh my God.
It'll kill him! He's not decoupled! He's having a fucking seizure! Power down! Now!
Heart rate 170!
Power down! Now!
Wow, the animuses back then were so unsafe.
Eileen, Warren here. I was all ready to apologize for the late.
Ah, shit! I accidentally hit it. Oops. Was this it?
Surrogate Initiative, test session 32. Wait. January 11th.
Can I... I can... Oh, shit.
Surrogate Initiative,
wait,
test session 32.
Wait, I will fast forward January.
Power down! Now!
Okay, here we go. Sorry, I dropped the controller.
Eileen, Warren here. I was all ready to apologize for the late call, but you seem to be away. Maybe with your son. Listen, since the unfortunate incident with Subject One, there's been a lot of dire talk around the office about my Animus project. About shutting it down. About it being unsafe. Typical top brass bullshit. And if they shut me down, then your surrogate initiative goes away too. I'm sure you're already well aware of that. Well, let me be the first to reassure you. This will not happen. I will not let them take this from me. From us. I will not let one death of an undiagnosed epileptic, I should add. I will not let this destroy the decades of incredible research done by our predecessors. And the 5 years I've spent perfecting the Animus. There's still more work to be done. And countless rewards to be reaped. So I wanted you to be the first to know. I have decided to volunteer myself as my second subject. I am convinced that the Animus is perfectly safe, provided I stay within the boundaries of my own ancestral bloodline. Next week I plan to prove this by staying a full 4 hours in the Animus. I would be grateful if you and your team would monitor my progress. And after this necessary but ridiculous proof of concept, I give you my word that I will work closely with you to solve your outstanding problems. Your surrogate initiative is a bold idea, and I do believe it is the future of the Animus project. But while we have the Animus itself, I do not want to waste precious opportunities to prove its safety. I'll see you in the office on Monday. Goodbye.
Wait, this is Warren Wittig's young version? Is this what I'm get from this? Is this Warren Wittig and he was subject to? Wow. I could say he's fucked up in his head because of that, but... well, whatever. Okay, let's find the next PC. No, I mean, let's find the next server. Or maybe in the camera room? No, let's go to the server room first. Going to the server room somehow, somewhere in here. Oh, there's my map. Server room, I'm hacking into server. Oh, but I should keep my eyes peeled for sticky notes. Because there are still some sticky notes left. Wait, what was this thing I had to do here? Oh, yeah, the calculation. Okay, so I have to fiddle around a little bit here. Okay, that's a little bit much. There's a little bit much too. Still too much. Okay, so this is too much. Maybe I have to... Oh, this is still too much. This is easy multiplication if I see it wide. It should be easy at least. So this is 2, and if I 2 and 2 is 4, this is 8, 16, and 23. I have the feeling it's an even number, so even number means I have to put together even numbers to get what I want out of this. Hmm. Maybe 7555? No. Maybe 257? No, 555 is too low. I need somewhere in between there, 7. Huh. Wait, maybe I need several sevens and just pull this number down. Ha ha! Wow, this was... Yeah, I had to think about that one. Initiate remote hacking. Yeah, why not? Oh no! 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 Please! No lines up and down. Yes, this time there are no boundaries up and down. So I'm safe to... Safe to fuck up, yeah. See? I'm fucking up on the easy ones now. I'm not sure where I want to get inside. Oh, I couldn't move properly. My struggle is real. There we go. And there we go. And oh shit, this is bad. This is the badness. This is all the badness. Boop! What? No! Okay, I'm back where I was, more or less. Give and take a few seconds. Oh no. Oh! I hate this part here. Yes! Okay, access granted.
Our initial research into the life of Ratana Gaiden focused on a period spanning his late teens to his early 30s. But our researchers came away unimpressed by his calm and stoic demeanor, with occasional flashes of extreme anger. This was not the sort of leading man we felt comfortable endorsing. We decided, therefore, to delve into his early childhood, with the hope that scenes of pre-colonial America might hold some appeal. As you can see here, there is a certain naive charm and innocence to this young boy. Unfortunately, our researchers found this young man's story deeply problematic as well. For one, the omnipresence of the Mohawk culture lacks the balance necessary to tell the true story of America. And secondly, the Mohawk language would certainly be an issue for most of our audience. We therefore feel that although Ratana Tankon's early life would be of some interest to our more educated viewers, it's unlikely that his story would appeal on a broader scale, being too foreign, as it were, to normal audiences. Our team recommends we pass on this property.
And yet... Still, we got into this. But yeah, we saw all those adventures in the head of... we saw all these adventures in the head of Desmond Miles outside there in the Animus. So the reason behind this, they have the samples of Subject 17 now, and they think they could use his analysis and publish it, but now they just... made up excuses to not publish that. So, yeah. It's only because they all emphasize the creed. Nothing is true. Everything is permitted. Even though I was not a big fan of Assassin's Creed 3, to be honest. I didn't like that much. First of all, the main character didn't really appeal to me for some reason. Not in any racist way. I think that's the only reason you would throw at me, because he's foreign and blah, blah, blah. No, this is not really the reason. I couldn't really pinpoint what it is. The character and His character, all in all, didn't really appeal to me. I don't know what it exactly was. I mean, maybe I was way too used to Ezio Auditore to get into this character, but after playing Black Flag, I can almost say that Black Flag appealed to me a little bit more. Well, not a little bit, a whole lot more. I don't... Even though... But the game appealed to me more because the story was a little bit deeper, for me at least. Oh, wait. This could be taken wrong. Maybe because I just like pirates. But that would be too stereotypical, wouldn't it? I don't know, it's just hard to say. I just didn't like Assassin's Creed 3. I hated the ending. I didn't really like the protagonists. He had likable features, but he was too stereotypical heroism indulged into him. Ezio Auditore had this, I don't know, this aura, this charisma, all in all. Everything he said, everything he did, sounded really good and deep, and he learned way faster. Ah, that is it! He learned way faster what it meant to be an assassin. He molded the creed in the new centuries after Altair was long gone. And... that's maybe it. And in Connor, you could always see this naive little child who always wanted to get his head through, who wanted his way. He was a really naive character, in my opinion. He was way too naive. Only at the very end of the game, he got a little bit more serious and got a little bit more understanding of what everything is really about. But that was a little bit too late. And then the actual ending. The actual ending pissed me off so much. Ah. And yeah, the gameplay didn't feel fluid. This was also negative in Assassin's Creed 3. And here in Black Flag, it was flawless. And I have to repeat this all over again in the credit section. God damn it. Okay, we hacked this. Only a few left. Well, a few is good. Wait, is this a sticky note? No, it's not a sticky note. I hacked already this. The good thing is the notes vanished. The bad thing is if I would look into... Oh, look at all those maps. How can I see if I already hacked a certain security room? Oh. I was going back, sorry. The bad thing is if I want to use... I will most likely try to find a map to... What's that? Try to find a map for all the sticky notes. And then I have to go through all the places again where I already found a sticky note to just... find out that I already used it up or found the sticky note, and then I have to go on and on. So I will come back to you if I found all the sticky notes, then I will show it to you, and maybe I will do a special episode where I show you every analog log, every text file and whatever I can find. Maybe I will leave out the things where I had to read a lot. Oh, Desmond Miles. Economy database, secondary memories? I didn't even see that. Wow, there's actual information on this. Okay, let's... Oh, I already hacked it. What can I even see here? War camera area 1. War camera area... War camera... Well, nothing to see here. This was boring. Okay, so now... Well, of course, we go to the elevator. One little boy, one! Well, it's me. One me, one! I have access to every area in the building now. More or less. Okay, I go to the lobby. I think the lobby should be the next area. I have this feeling. Yes, there we go. Server room and security camera room. I think I already hacked the security camera, but I wanna check if there's something new on the camera. Otherwise, the camera's again, Desmond? Okay. No, there's only this lonely person in there. As always. Good. So, let's hack those PCs. Don't suspect me, I'm from the support team. Is this a hard one or an easy one? Well, at least it doesn't have the annoying things. Shit! Shit, I missed my opportunity. Yeah! That's the stuff. I always forget that I can move on those lines. There we go. Ha! This was an easy one again. Bypassing standard security protocols. Connection successful.
February 12, 1981. Qualitative personal interview with Subject 1 on ancestral research regarding Avalon de Grand Prix. How are you feeling? Any side effects?
Not really. Aside from the headaches. They've been worse since I started staying in longer. But I don't want to stop. I like her. I want to know what she does next.
What's it like? Reliving her memories.
So different. The Animus, I mean. The past. At first it was confusing. Distracting. Like New Orleans, the stench. I wasn't expecting all the smells.
Smell is the sense most directly linked to memory.
When I'm in her memories, it's like I can smell more than I usually can.
In general, women have a more acute sense of smell than men do. I had wondered how that would translate. Anything else?
Yeah. She's smaller than me, but it's like her body could do more.
Did that surprise you?
At first, yeah. The ERA people might hate me for this or whatever, but I don't usually think of girls that way. Climbing things. My mom, my sisters. The animal feeling of Aveline sinking her hidden blade in the throat of...
Go on.
It doesn't feel feminine. What I think of as feminine. But then at the same time, it does. Her center of gravity is way lower. That was a surprise. How easy it is to land. How steady I am on her feet. Sorry. This is hard to talk about.
No, it's fascinating. This is what we need. Pure experience, in your own words.
Okay.
Can you tell me about Gerald Blunk?
What about him?
He and Avalon were close, but we haven't been able to ascertain if he might be your missing ancestor. Do her memories suggest anything to you? Does this make you uncomfortable? Remember, these are her memories. You're just playing them back. It's not even acting. You're a researcher.
Like you say, I haven't experienced her consummating anything. That would be... Anyway, I think maybe she was confused.
Oh.
Well, first of all, I don't really know for sure, okay? I mean, guys think about sex more than girls, right? That's a fact.
As a researcher, what did you observe?
Does it mean she's more like a guy if she thinks about... Is that why she's able to assassinate... Well, okay, here's the thing. I don't know her thoughts, but from what's in her memories, physically, the fidgeting, some hesitation, what she looked at, who she looked away from, the things she didn't say when I expected her to. If I had to guess what it meant, I would think she was thinking about sex. But I'm a guy, so I would think that, right? So what does it mean for women to act that way? It has to mean something else, right?
As a subject, you're able to observe more finely than I am in review. What about unwanted attention from men.
Well, I thought that would be the hardest thing to deal with. I'm not into that, for the record. Not at all.
Yes, I know.
But the way she dealt with it, it happens so often. It's like you stop noticing everything she does to avoid it. Crossing the street, eyes in the back of her head. She knew how to handle herself. When she was charming, felt kind of similar to killing. Or the build-up to killing. Can we take a break, Mr. Vidic?
Of course. Ready to go on?
Yes.
Avalyn was black.
And white. On her father's side.
You're sensitive to that?
I guess. I mean, I'm white. Aveline looks black, so that's different. But you get used to it. Like with the girl thing. Until someone makes you not used to it.
What do you mean?
I don't think I've ever had to think so much about what I'm wearing or how I'm walking. But Aveline, it's like she goes through her whole life in these uniforms.
People expect her to behave in a certain way.
Definitely. Sometimes I worry I'll slip up and play too relaxed at the warehouse and, I don't know, blow her cover.
You can't blow her cover.
I know. I'm just replaying the memories. I can't change them, I know. But I see it, right? It's a risk. It's...
stressful?
Yes. It's best when she goes out as an assassin. On the roofs or in the bayou. I think she was more relaxed that way. Can you imagine? You're only relaxed when you're going to kill someone.
Let's stick to memories rather than imagination. What about the slaves?
They're kind of just everywhere. I mean, that sounds bad. Slavery is bad, but no one's acting like slavery's bad. It's fun when she frees slaves. Is it supposed to be fun?
We're not looking for supposed to. Focus on what it is.
Oh god, the recording dies. And you know what this audio log just want us to do? The audio log wants us to play Assassin's Creed Liberation. Which I won't do. I will not play the spin-offs, most likely. I think I will only play the spin-offs if they are given to me by some way. But I would not really buy them myself, cause I'm not convinced that they have the content and the impact the main games have. So yeah, I'm really not. I have them on my wish list on Steam, I guess. I'm not sure. Well, I have every game I want to play, or I found out and want to play on my wish list. So yeah, I could just blatantly say it. Most, in my description thing under me, there is a link to my wish list. So if you want me to play a certain game and it is on my Steam wish list, you can point it out to me that you want to see it. And if you're really generous and would really see me react or review a game, then you can even buy it for me, maybe? No? I don't know. It just is weird to ask someone to buy a game if you don't even know that person as well as you should. But yeah, it's a thing. This is just blatantly how I said it, and I should stop it now and go on. Wait. The computer does not look hacked. Why is it not red and flickery? Oh, another handy... another smartphone minigame. Whoa. Oh shit, it had those fucking red lines again. Shit, it's one of the hard ones. No! I hate them!
Shit, I hate this. This is too hard. I hate this so much. You can't even...
What? What happened there? This is so hard. This is so hard. And that's what she said, by the way. I hate this! Come on! The fuck! Shit! Shit. Come on, turn. Yes! Just have to be quicker and react faster, like an assassin with eagle vision. No, this doesn't slow down. In Assassin's Creed, it slowed down.
We are attempting to synchronize the DDS system. This will only take a moment. We are almost there. The DDS is now in sync. Thank you for your patience. We hope you enjoy your experience. Rudolf II invited many notable figures to his court, making Prague the center of European culture. Among them were Englishman Edward Kelly and his stepdaughter, Elizabeth Jane Weston. Observe her and report any alleged collusion.
This is a data log we had. Or is it?
Seriously, that was all? Unreleased video from Project Legacy. Okay, I thought there would be more, but...
You didn't hear?
This was cheap. This was really, really cheap. Okay, let's go to the... Wait, is this a sticky note? No, it just looked blue. I'm blue, I'm debub, die. Hello, you guy drinking coffee here on your table. I'm blue, da-dum-dee-da-dum-da. I'm hacking a server device and it will be no fun. Mathematics are not my strong suit. It used to be, but it's not anymore. For some strange reason I can't even understand in this regard. Wait, is this... Oh, I'm close. I'm very close. No, I'm not close. I lied. I'm a terrible person. Oh, this is almost it already, but... Did it. Oh, this is a dirty laugh, wasn't it? Oh, it's so late. It's 2 a.m. And I still can't stop this. Oh, I have to go to sleep. Oh, not this shit again. God damn it. Fuck. Fuck. Here we go. So if we don't screw it up... Oh, I should start at the bottom. Fuck! Really have to be fast in this area. Shit. What? Oh, come on! This is bullshit! This is total bull! Oh, no. Ah, shit! This was going upwards. I forgot that. Okay, let's do it again. Let's keep it calm. Damn, shit! It's too fast!
for me. I'm a slow human being and I'm tired.
Oh, shit. Come on, open up. Come on, come on, come on. There's a gap, there's a gap. Gap, there's a... I did it!
Surrogate Initiative, Test Session 37, August 9th, 1981. Host, Eileen Bach. DNA sample, SB1970.
Open! Good morning, Miss Kurtz. You look well, considering the circumstances. Are you rested? Have you eaten? Your friends are dead, Miriam. Bartle Schink and all his navios, his Edelweiss pirates, executed for 5 counts of murder.
It has a trial. You must be proud.
There was no need! They were scum! All of them! You hear me? All of you are scum! Scum! Scum!
I see it so clearly now. She didn't break, did they? You have nothing!
Quiet, girl!
You don't have the artifact. If you did, you wouldn't be talking to me at all. Never use lay seat!
I said quiet!
Never use lay seat!
Quiet!
Never use lay seat!
Quiet!
I think this was Hitler.
Get her out! Get her out! We're losing her! Shut it down! Everything! Eileen, open your eyes. Can you hear me? Eileen!
Power's off! Get the physician in here!
Step aside, son.
Eileen, talk to me. Can you open your eyes?
Claire.
Oh, God. Oh, God.
No response.
Bleeding effect.
All right. Notes towards a speech in honor of Dr. Eileen Bach's premature retirement. When I first learned of Dr. Bach's unfortunate accident, I couldn't help but feel a great sense of loss at... No. Dr. Eileen Bach has and always will be a friend and colleague. When I first learned of her unfortunate accident, I was shocked, of course. To see any friend injured in such a way is deeply upsetting. And to further learn that her injuries were severe enough to force a premature conclusion to her brilliant career, well, I would not wish that fate on anyone. But if there is any solace to be found in her accident, it may be this: that she was injured in service of her research, in service of work that she cherished most dearly. And it is due to her diligence that some of the mysteries of genetic memory have been further illuminated. And while it is true that work on her project, the Surrogate Initiative, as she called it, has been temporarily halted, the copious amount of work she has done over the past 3 years has been incredibly valuable. So while her work has been suspended for the time being, her legacy will most certainly live on.
Quiet, Joan! Quiet!
What a dick! Oh, the Animus was a very, very dangerous device. A really, really dangerous device. Is there something more coming, or is the audio file just ending? Yep, it's ending. Okay. Animus was one of the most dangerous devices ever seen so far. Even though I don't feel that tired, even though
it's... Where did you hear that? I haven't heard anything.
I keep my ear to the ground.
What are we talking about? Is there a sticky note in here, maybe? Or maybe around here again? Wait, I didn't check those ledgers for sticky notes. Maybe they are well hidden. Or maybe they are hidden in plain sight. Like assassins do. Even though it is ridiculous that you can stand right in front of your target, but as long as four girls Every standing around you, nothing will happen. Maybe behind this. The feeling maybe behind this is a sticky note. Could be. It's a possibility. Possibility I will not... Wait, what's that? Can I go in there? Is this a room I couldn't go in? Oh, it's a bathroom, okay. I have security clearance 3. Can I now go in the woman's bathroom? Maybe here? No? Okay. Wait, where are the computer? Where are the computers I'm looking for?
Have you ever been to Chicago?
Once. Well, Chicago Heights, actually. Huh? I drove through it.
I'm thinking about moving there after my visa runs out here.
You American?
Yeah. I have a few friends working for Bloom down there. I think that sort of thing is more up my alley. Hardware, infrastructure.
Not interesting at all. Oh, security clearance 3. And nobody's suspicious, and I haven't even got caught once. Are there more sticky notes? Yeah, I still look for sticky notes, even though I... Oh, there is one! 15. Then revolutions in America and France bled into revolutions and into more revolutions into Russia and Mexico and India, and the sickening list goes on as men and women fought and died for the right to be indolent and sick and pleasured. But she guide us into the grey, has returned after a sleep of tens of thousands of millennia, and we submit to live and work at her side. We, the instruments of the first will. If we were only instruments, why we got a free will? Why did they gave us free will? I mean, this wouldn't make any sense if they only intend to use us. Okay, so let's see if this is hard or if this is easy. And here we go. Nice one. Okay, I can skip this? No, I can't. Okay. I had the feeling I could skip it, but...
So, this will be a short one, Dad. Something to remember me by if things go south. If I don't make it out of the temple today. I've tried to be optimistic about all this, but I just can't. I think spending all this time at Connor's memories has made me anxious. I mean, his story is so painful in so many ways. Still, he never lost hope. Even when his faith and others eroded. I can only believe that what we are doing is the right thing. And that I can stop this disaster. I know this. I mean, the technology is there, waiting for us to use it. I'm the final piece of the puzzle. Something in my genes, or my memories. Some final piece of code to switch the whole thing on. That's why I'm here. That's why they brought me here. Only, I don't know what I'll have to give up in return. My sanity? My life? It's impossible to say. I do know this. Our battle with the Templars will not be over. But whatever's inside that temple is not an ending. It's just another chapter in this endless story. it'll be your job. And Mom's, and Sean's, and Rebecca's. To keep turning the pages. You know, I keep thinking about something Orson Welles once said. Something like, if you want a happy ending, it all depends on where you stop telling your story. So maybe that's the answer. Maybe that's how people keep marching forward. If something goes wrong and they're dead, something happens to me. When you tell my story years from now, please tell them the one about how I lost my way, and then I found it again. Just in time to save the world. And just end it there. That'll keep everyone smiling. Goodbye, Dad. Say hello to Mom. Tell her I love her, okay? Tell her I love you both.
This is heart-wrenching. Oh, Desmond. This didn't turn red either. Hello, security man. It doesn't even bother you that I just go into the rooms where only people with a security clearance 3 have actually entrance permission. Wait, there was one sticky note in the one room. There should be one here too. Or maybe not. We almost did it. We almost have every piece collected. How is the answer if you are in a labyrinth? Always go white and you will eventually find where you have to go. I try to go in one direction only, if it's possible. But I have the bad idea that I have the bad feeling that this is not the right thing to do here. Okay, so we are turning this around, round, round, and round. Until we hopefully get to something. Why is it so hard this time? Do I even need to pee? Why does this take me so long again? You are actually free to skip ahead and see what comes next after I solve this freaking shit thing. Come on. Oh, this can't be so hard. Where could be... I mean, there is the thing I need to be. But I can't get there, cause of bullshit. Oh, come on! Maybe I need to go on the other side? But I can't! There's no way to get down! There we go. No! Fuck! Are you freaking serious right now? Oh, the other ones were so easy!
Why is this so hard? Come on. Don't be a dick, game. I mean, you were so nice to me this whole time, and now you're digging.
Well, actually, that's a lie. You were not always nice. There were plenty of times where you were being a dick a lot of times.
Come on.
I'm really just trying random directions now.
I don't even know how you would solve them other than just running around aimlessly and hoping that you will someday land on the green line. I mean, so I can go there, then I can go up, then I can go this way, then I can go down again. Then this is way too many directions I can go. I'm not smart enough person to do this shit constantly. Come on, I would just want to be done with it. Wait, was this a... fudge. Oh, why am I always ending up here? No. 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 Stop. Sticking around! Fuck! Why is this so hard? Okay, you know what? I come back-
Finally! It took so long! Well, about 3 or 5 minutes, but I did it. I don't know how.
Oh, really? How long is this? Oh, this is freaking long. Okay. Olivier, I need your guys to get me everything on the observatory by the end of Friday at the latest. Can you do it? No, are you crazy? We don't even know where it is yet. And Friday is a holiday. A holiday? Really? Do your people realize that working here is a privilege? If they care about their jobs, they'll come in, and it will be an honor. And no, I'm not crazy. I'm getting a lot of heat from Letizia. If we don't get it done, she'll take it out on devils, and all our work will be lost. Does she even know how anything works here? She has her own pressures. I realize that, but we are already working overtime. And when are we going to discuss how the plot of Devils has to change to accommodate this observatory business? How am I going to sell it? You're not going to. It's too sensitive. So we're just collecting the memories for no reason? Not for no reason. Letizia will use it. This is ridiculous. You want us to devote our lives to finding information we are not allowed to develop or understand or use in any way? It won't help sales, and my people will never see their work rewarded in public. How am I supposed to motivate them? I don't know. Get them breakfast, pain or chocolate, coffee. Pretend to sneak in some coffee liquor, a little beer with lunch. Feed them. They'll forgive you. Again? They're not going to keep falling for this. Yes, they will. Wet and circuses. Look it up. It's a thing.
Oh, yeah. That's a thing in Rome. Wet and games.
Come on. Be serious. I am being serious. Remember? None of this come from me. Letizia needs what she needs. If you want the project to continue, we have to keep her happy. The observatory doesn't have anything to do with pirates anyway. It would only complicate things. Take the focus off the action. But it's fascinating. I realize it's more mature and complex. I can't believe I'm the one arguing this, but we are crazy not to use it. Imagine, we could be selling to pirate fans and conspiracy theorists, all at the same time.
The potential for market growth is huge. Yeah, but you are working for Templars, so they don't want to know the public about the thing about the Templars and the Assassins. They only want to sell games and try to finance their own finding to just rule us all. We cannot use it, so please stop asking. This is insane. As you already know, Melanie, this is a girl. This company is subsidiary of Abstergo Industries, and Abstergo Industries has a different culture. They are hierarchical and rule-driven. We may not always like it, but if we want to advance in this company, we have to be careful. You're protecting her. I'm protecting you. I know we have our arguments from time to time, but I know you care deeply about our work, and I don't want you to get yourself ejected from the conversation. We need you. Do you understand?
Yeah, I get it. Pick my battles. It's common sense. I don't know why this one thing is bothering me so much right now. I'm just tired.
As am I.
So I don't need to find someone else to help me? No, we'll get it done. Somehow.
I will personally bring the coffee liquor for breakfast.
Lol, thanks. I'll find some way to get them excited about it in the meantime.
If it makes you feel better, I can tell you a secret.
What?
If we are successful with the observatory, Abstergo may develop a Las Vegas attraction to accompany the release of Devils.
What?
They are looking into a partnership with those aquatic circus people you like. Imagine celebrating with the whole team at live-action gladiator show. Assassins vs. Templars vs. Pirates vs. Sharks.
What?
They're giving out that there are Assassins and Templars existing, but they don't want anyone to know about the observatory, okay?
Whoa! I'm in awe! How do you come up with this stuff?
Oh, I have all kinds of little things saved in files here and there. I always think I get around to doing something with them in a quiet moment.
But they are never quiet moments. Oh well, you retire someday.
Not if I'm lucky.
Me neither.
Okie dokie, only 3 more computers to go. Okay, where's the next computer? The next computer should be upstairs. Yeah, the next computer has to be upstairs. Come on, one faster.
I keep my ear to the ground.
Oh yeah, you again. I don't
That's
care.
An odd way to describe a job. I wish I was researching a pirate, not a dull, dreary, pre-romantic poet.
You got the sucky job of this business. It's great. It's really great. Hi, baby. You know everything about pirates? I am a true pirateer. No, privateer. No, I'm a pirate. I was a pirate, now I'm an assassin. I don't even know what I am anymore. Okay, get up here. Oh, I have a feeling where the last computers are. I think I know where the last computers are. And they are definitely not up here. And why is this loading? I mean, it's just a small segment of the game. Oh, there is a computer here. There's even a server room here. Okay, I didn't say nothing. I mean, I did say nothing about this. Okay, let's see. It's a sphere. Oh, actually, I like those more because they are not as critical and you don't have to think so much. Oh, shit. Oh, there's no wet thing. Good. Okay, get wide. Shit. And we got it. Yes. Ah, this is what I could skip. Assassin's Creed Black Flag. Oliver Brownen. Chapter 3. She was in the old Shillela, a tavern halfway between Hathorn and Bristol. A regular haunt of mine.
And sometimes, in the summer, when mother and father toiled over the shearing at home, and I'd have to make more regular trips into town than several times a day. I admit, I hadn't taken much notice of her at first, which is unusual for me, because I like to pride myself on knowing the exact location of any pretty woman nearabouts, and besides, the Shillela wasn't exactly the sort of place you expected to find a pretty woman. A woman, yes, a certain type of woman, but this girl I could see wasn't like that. She was young, about my age, and she wore a white linen coif and a smock. Looked to me like a domestic. But what made me aware of her wasn't her clothes. It was the loudness of her voice, which was quite in contrast to the way she looked. She was sitting with three men, all of them older than her, who I recognized at once. Tom Cobley, his brother Seth, and Julian somebody, whose surname escaped me. Oh, but who worked with them? Three men with whom I had traded words, if not blows, before. The kind who looked down their noses at me because they thought I looked down my nose at them. Who liked me no more than I liked them, which was not a lot. They were sat forward on their stools and watching this young girl with leering, wolfish eyes that betrayed a darker purpose. Even though they were all smiles, banging on the table, encouraging her as she drank dry a flagon of ale. No, she did not look like one of the women who usually frequented the tavern, but it seemed that she was determined to act like one of them. The flagon was about as big as she was, and she wiped her hand across her mouth and banged it to the table. The men responded with cheers, shouting for another one, and no doubt pleased to see her wobble slightly on her stool. Probably couldn't believe their luck. Pretty little thing like that. I watched as they let the girl drink yet more ale with the same tumult accompanying her success, and then, as she did the same as before and wiped her hands across her mouth, but with an even more pronounced wobble this time. A look passed between them, a look that seemed to say, "The job is done. Yeah, we're going to take her and we're going to rape her. What are you doing? Shitbags!" Tom and Julian stood, and they began in their words to escort her to the door because, "You've had too much to drink, my lovely. Let's get you home, shall we? Or in the next alley, and there we will wake you, you assholes." "Too bad," smirked Thess, thinking he was saying it under his breath, even though the whole tavern heard him. "Let's be getting you to bed." I passed a look to the barman, who dropped his eyes and used his apron to blow his nose. A customer sat down the bar from me turned away as I appealed to him with my eyes. "Bastards! Might as well have looked to the cat for help." I saw then with a sigh, banged down my tankard, stepped off my stool and followed the cobblers into the road outside. "Is this Edward Kenway, who is just about to meet his girlfriend and then he left it behind to become a pirate and she left him and... Wait, what happened to him in the end? Are we gonna find out that... Did I already forget the ending?" I blinked as I stepped from the darkness of the tavern into bright sunlight. My cart was there, roasting in the sun. Beside it, another one that I took to belong to the cobblers. On the other side of the road was a yard with houses set far back, but no sign of a farmer. We were all alone on the highway. Just me, the two cobbler brothers, Julian, and the girl, of course. "Well, Tom Cobley," I said, "the thing you've seen on a fine afternoon, where just you and your cronies are getting drunk and getting a poor defenseless young woman even drunker." The girl sagged as Tom Cobley let go her arm and turned to address me, his finger already raised. "Now just you stay out of this, Edward Kenway, you young good-for-nothing. You're as drunk as I am, and your morals just as loose. I don't need to be given a talking to by the likes of you." Thess and Julian had turned as well. The girl was glazed over, like her mind had turned in for the night, even if her body was still awake. "Well," I smiled, "loose morals might have, Tom Cobley. I'm, oh, loose morals I might have, Contumclo Blay, but I don't need to pour ale down a girl's throat before taking her to bed, and I certainly don't need two friends to help me at the task. Contumclo Blay Weddenet. Oh, Weddenet! Why, you cheeky little bastard! I'm going to put her on my cart, is what I'm going to do, and take her home. I have no doubt that you intend to put on your cart and take her home. It's what you plan to do between putting her on the cart and reaching home that concerns me. That concerns you, does it? A broken nose and a couple of broken whips will be concerning you, unless you mind your own bloody business. Squinting, I glanced at the highway, where three bordering the dirt track shone gold and green in the sun, and in the distance was a lone figure on a horse, shimmering and indistinct. I took a step forward, and if there had been any warmth or humor in my manner, then it disappeared now, almost of its own accord. There was a steeliness in my voice when I next spoke. Now you just leave that girl alone, Tom Cobley, or I won't be responsible for my actions. The three men looked at one another, in a way they'd done as I asked. They let go of the girl, and she seemed almost relieved to slide to her haunches, placing one hand on the ground and looking at us all with bleary eyes, evidently oblivious to all that was being discussed on her behalf. Meanwhile, I looked the Koblays and weighed up the odds. Had I ever fought three at once? Well, no, because if you were fighting three at once, then you weren't so much fighting. You were getting beaten up. But come on, Edward Kenway. I told myself, yes, on the one hand, it was three men, but one of them was Tom Cobley, who was no spring chicken. About my father's age. Another one was Seth Cobley, who was Tom Cobley's son. And if you can imagine the kind of person who would help his father get a young girl drunk, well, then you can imagine that sort of person Seth Cobley was, which was to say a maggoty. Underhand type. More likely to run away from a fight with wet breeches than stand his ground. And what's more, they were drunk. On the other hand, I was drunk too. Plus, they had Julian, who, going on looks alone, which is all I had, could handle himself. But I had another idea. That lone rider I could see in the distance. If I could just hold off the Koblays till he arrived, the odds were likely to shift back in my favor. After all, if he was of good character, the lone winder was bound to stop and help me out. Well, Tom Cobley, I said, you got the advantage over me. That's obvious for anyone to see. But you know, I just wouldn't be able to look my mother in the eye, knowing I'd let you and your cronies abduct this pretty young thing. I glanced up the road to where that lone winder was getting closer. Come on then, I thought, don't hang about. So, I continued, if you end up leaving me in a bloody heap by the side of this here road, and carry that young lassie off in any way, I'm going to have to do all that I can to make it as difficult for you as possible, and perhaps see to it that you go on your way with a black eye, maybe a pair of throbbing bollocks for your troubles. Tom Cobley spat. I hate spitting, or spitting. Then gazed at me through wizardness, slitty eyes. Well, are you just going to stand there talking about it all day, Edward Kenway, or are you going to attend to your task? Because time waits for no man, he grinned an evil grin. I've got people to see, things to do. Aye, that's right, and the longer you leave it, the more chance that poor Lassie has of sobering up, eh? I don't mind telling you, I'm getting tired of all this talk, Kenway. He turned to Julian. How about we teach this little bastard a lesson? Oh, and one more thing before we start, Master Kenway. You ain't fit to shine your mother's shoes, you understand? That hit me hard. I don't mind admitting. Having someone like Tom Cobley, who had all the morals of a frothing dog and about half the intelligence, able to reach into my soul. If my guilt was an open wound, then stick this sum in that open wound and cause me even more pain. Well, it certainly firmed up my resolve, if nothing else. Julian pushed his chest forward and with a snarl advanced. 2 steps away from me, he raised his fists, dipped his right shoulder and swung. And I don't know who Julian was used to fighting outside taverns, but somebody with less experience than me, that's for sure, because I'd already taken note of the fact that he was right-handed, and he couldn't have made his intentions more obvious if he'd tried. The dirt rose in clouds around my feet as I dodged easily and brought my own right up sharply. He shouted in pain as I cocked him under the jaw, and if it had just been him, the battle would have been won. But Tom Koblay was already upon me. I just saw him out of the corner of my eye. It was too late to react, and I was dazed by a fist that slammed into my temple. What is his temple? Do you mean your crotch, or do you mean your head? I staggered slightly as I turned to meet the attack. My fists were swinging much more widely than I'd have liked. I was hoping to land a lucky blow, needing to put at least one of the men down to even up the numbers. But none of my punches made contact. Plus, Julian had recovered from my first punch with alarming speed and now came at me again. He swung and his right hand connected with my chin, spinning me about so that I almost lost my balance. My head fell off, my hair was in my eyes, and I was in disarray. And guess who came in with his boots kicking? That warm Seth Koblay shouting encouragement to his father and Julian at the same time. And the little bastard was lucky. His boot caught me in the midriff, and already off balance, I lost my footing and fell. The worst thing you can do in a fight against 3 men is fall. Once you fall, it's over. Through their legs, I saw the lone rider up the highway. Now, my only chance at salvation, possibly my only hope of getting out of this alive. But what I saw made my heart sink. Not a man on a horse, a tradesman who would dismount and come rushing to my aid. No, the lone rider was a woman. She was riding astride the horse. Not side saddle, but even though was lady. She wore a bonnet and a light-colored summery dress, and the last thing I thought before the Koblay boots obscured my view and the kicks came waning in was that she was beautiful. But beauty wasn't going to save me now. "Hey," I heard, "you 3 men, stop what you are doing right now." They turned to look up at her and removed their hats, shuffling in line to hide the sight of me, who lay coughing on the ground. "What is going on here?" she demanded to know. From the sound of her voice, I could tell she was young, and while not highly born, definitely well-bred. Too well-bred, surely to be riding unaccompanied? "We were just teaching this young man here some manners," rasped Tom Koblay out of breath. Exhausting business, it was kicking me half to death. "Well, it doesn't take 3 of you to do that, does it?" she replied. I could see her now, twice as beautiful as I'd first thought as she glowered at the Koblays, who for their part looked thoroughly mollified. She dismounted. "More to the point, what you doing with this young lady here?" pointing at the girl, who still sat dazed and drunk on the ground. "Oh ma'am, this is a young friend of ours who had too much to drink." The lady darkened. "She's most certainly not your young friend. She is a maidservant, and if I don't get her back home before my mother discovers that she is absconding, then she will be an unemployed maidservant." She looked pointedly from one man to the next. "I know you, man, and I think I know exactly what has been going on here. Now you will leave this young man alone and be on your way before I am of a mind to take this further." With much bowing and scraping, the Koblays clambered aboard the cart and were soon gone. Meanwhile, the woman dismounted and knelt down to speak to me. "My name is Carolyn Scott. My family lives on Hawkins Lane in Bistril. Let me take you back there and tend to your wounds." I cannot, my lady," I said, sitting up and trying to manage a grin. I have work to do, she stood.
I see. And did I assess the situation correctly?
I picked up my hat and began to brush the dirt from it. It was even more better now.
You did, my lady. Then I owe you my thanks, and so will Rose when she sobers up. She's a willful girl, not always the easiest to staff, but nevertheless, I don't want to see her suffer for her impetuousness, whatever that means.
She was an angel, I decided then, and as I helped them mount the horse, Caroline holding onto Rose, who lolled drunkenly over the neck of the horse, I had a sudden thought. Can I see you again, my lady? To thank you properly when I look a little more presentable, perhaps?
She gave me a regretful look. I fear my father would not approve, she said, and with that shook
the reins and left. That night, I sat beneath the thatch of our cottage, staring out over the pastures as the sun went down. Usually my thoughts would concern either the possibility of escape or wrestling with the inevitability of my future. That night, I thought of Caroline. Caroline Scott of Hawkins Lane. That was beautiful. And you are most certainly hacked. Okay, so the next thing to do is go into the server room. Let's go into the server room. Let's go into the server room. Nobody home? Really? Okay, you are still hacked. Wait, did I maybe miss any sticky notes in here? I know, I looked more or less thoroughly through this office already. Oh! This is actually a nice thing. This looks nice, really nice. Well, I have the feeling I went in there for no reason at all. And this will be a very, very long episode. Maybe I will split it. Maybe I will do that. Even though I'm not sure yet. Maybe this will be a two-part episode. Maybe. Not sure yet. Really, absolutely not sure. Okay, where's this freaking room I have to go? Ah, here we go. Here it is. Oh yeah, the number thing again. So this is too much. Haha! Cool, connection successful, and now we remotely hack. And it's one of those again. Wet lines or no wet lines? Shit, it's wet lines. God damn it. God damn it. What? Oh, come on, this is not nice. What? What happened there? I was in the clear. I most likely was in the clear. What happened there? Come on. The gap was not long enough. Shit, shit, shit. Nice and easy, nice and easy.
Shit! I totally didn't see that. Come on, come on, come on, little shit. What? Why is it going the same direction? Uh-oh. What? Oh, come on! Oh, God. I think I really need some sleep, man. This took ages. Oh, we know him. I think it is the one I think it is. Haytham Kenway. Wait. Haytham Kenway? Edward Kenway? What? So, Edward Kenway is a descendant of Haytham Kenway? Suave, debonair, and clever, Haytham Kenway was a hero. For a generation of men desperate for a decisive and charismatic leader, slain by the ungrateful son who could not appreciate the wisdom of his pragmatic, waste-blind approach to politics and personal life, Kenway's tenure as Grand Master of the Colonial White ended abruptly in 1781. Lies! All lies! Okay, next one. How many are left anyway? I want to go one time in here. Just one time. Just to see if there's anything to see. But there's most likely nothing to see. Yep, definitely nothing to see and nothing to hear. The camera rooms were the most pointless thing in this game so far. Well, there was one occasion where the camera room was useful, but that's not a lot. That's really not a lot. So, what? So the only thing left is the lowest floor. The server rooms. So there must be the last and final PC. And after that, only the sticky notes remain. Yeah, there we go. There we go. Wait, two? Do I have 31 computers? I thought I already have 32. We will see. We will see. Hello, core room. There we go. I really think I should find some sticky notes. But for now... Oh no, not this shit again. Maybe this one is easier. No, it's harder. I wound a little bit before I leave the recording just to see myself. Oh, I always end up in the same. I always end up here, and this is freaking nightmare. Ah, there we go. Ha ha, this was good. Core access granted. Extraction sequence initiated. Core breached. Accessing information. Oh god. Agent evaluation report for Juano Otso Berg dated 12/11. Wait. I want to see something first. Okay, so it's not described. Good. Skills 5. Inconurans? What? I can't read this. The second thing. The third is courage, initiative, dependability, judgment, teamwork, leadership, and tact. Okay. Agent evaluation report of Giovanni Otso. This would have to have been leaked from within. This is a classified document.
spewed on our own network. Someone should hang for this. Oh. Strengths, experienced, agents, military special forces, background is a definitive asset. Obedient, follows orders without question. Leadership qualities. Agent lacks finesse, but inspires loyalty in others. Dedicated. Agent is wholly committed to our cause. Definite potential. Could be IS material. Investigative spy? Weaknesses. Agent has a young 30-year-old daughter. Could be a liability. Other notes. Agent is ready to take on greater challenges. Recommend giving agent leadership responsibilities. Recommend sending agent on level 5 missions. Titipo Hasek. Did we ever met this guy? A dashing photo of Otso Berg, labeled Helsinki, Finland. Unclear who took this or why. This photo labeled Florence, Italy, makes it clear we have a leak. Who survived to transmit this photo? Photo labeled Cairo, Egypt, okay. This one's labeled Cairo, Egypt. Sigma team strikes again. The poster claims Abstergo agents kidnap William Miles, but Miles is not pictured. Could be anything. This update agent evaluation of Otso Berg data 12/12/2003 confirms that leak persisted and perhaps still exists. Updated strengths. Demonstrate a great deal of courage, initiative, resourcefulness and dedication. Updated weaknesses. Distinguishing mark, facial scar burn, reparative surgery should be considered. Other notes. Following assassin attack of blah, see attached security report. Agent tracked down the enemy and located the Florence hideout. Agent led Sigma strike team against the Florence assassins, responsible for the termination of 3 assassins. Survived assassin ambush. Agent should not be held accountable for the loss of his team. Kukatuma, what? Okay. This was boring. Okay, only one more to go. Maybe we get a secret message. After we unlocked everything, that is. Oh. Oh, no, 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 no. We are not looking into this now. This was an accident. And why am I upstairs again? Fuck's sake. Okay, I reached the white room. I reached the white room. Almost made a doo-doo there. Almost. Is this a shower? Wow. Would be odd if I could find a sticky note in here. But let's check the PC. And it's one of those fucking spheres again. Oh, wait. Oh, God. Oh, this was fast. Okay, that's fine by me.
Oh. Surrogate Initiative, test session 27, October 21st, 1980. Host Eileen Buck, DNA sample SB1970.
Miriam. There is no good reason for you to be here. But your intransigence requires that I detain you until you give me information I can act upon. The location of the artifact, perhaps. Or the whereabouts of your leader, Bartel Schink. Just a little something to give Minister Goebbels some encouragement that we are on the right track.
How about a nice hug? He looks so sad in all his photographs.
Yes, he does, doesn't he? Perhaps you could pay him a visit yourself. He likes beautiful women. Actresses, musicians.
Pirates?
That's right, pirates. Pirates of the Edelweiss. Isn't that what you kids call yourselves? It's very amusing. And illegal, of course.
Breaking Hitler's laws is half the fun.
Oh, I imagine so. I imagine you were having a wonderful time just before we captured you and your insurgent friends.
And that's the end of it.
Damn it. Why can't we sustain the signal for more than just a few minutes? I need to relax.
That's not the issue. This is dangerous work. These memories aren't in your bloodline. That's why it's not holding.
There's got to be a solution.
Any idea what they mean by the artifact? I've heard it a few times now.
Not sure. I don't think Miriam knew either. Not much comes into her mind when she asks about it.
But she's protecting the other members of her group, the Edelweiss Pirates or something?
Yeah. Bartol Schenk. Have we looked him up?
No, we can.
We should. Put your intern on it.
Right. High priority.
Yeah. This isn't getting any easier. Jesus.
Hello?
Hi, Seamus. It's Mom.
Hey.
How are you?
Dad! It's Mom!
Hello, Eileen.
Hi, Carl. How's Seamus?
Great. We were out shopping for school clothes.
Yeah. The summer just sped by.
They all do.
I never seem to notice. No windows in the office.
Right. Trapped in the lab. So, did you need to talk?
Yes, sorry. I was curious about your mother, actually.
Oh. Okay.
How much did she talk about the war when you were growing up?
Not often. Bits and pieces. Why?
I was doing some research last week about World War II, and something came up about the Edelweiss Pirates, or the Navajos, and your mother's name popped up.
Really? That's an odd coincidence.
Does any of that ring a bell?
Yeah. Mom ran with that group while the war was on. There were a group of kids who wanted to avoid the Hitler Youth programs, but in later years they escalated their activities to, bigger ideas like vandalism and sabotage.
But why Navajos and pirates?
Just some of the names they used. Navajos, Edelweiss Pirates, you know, kids. There were little pins, little white flowers. I may still have hers.
That's interesting.
And this is for work, researching my mother?
Not exactly, but... sorry, I can't talk about it.
Right. You never could.
Hey, don't. I didn't mean to be flippant.
No. Don't mind me. All for the greater good.
I like to think so. Ah! Ah!
Power down! You all right?
Damn it! 5 months of this bullshit! We're floundering.
Take it easy, Eileen. You're just stressed.
I am not stressed. I'm frustrated. I'd like to go again this afternoon.
No. There is no reason to rush this.
We're hardly rushing. We're running into the same wall over and over again. Why can't we push through? Why can't you keep me in the Animus longer than 2 minutes?
Because surrogate genetic memory data is fragile. The EEG is exploding and your brain is doing too much work. The longer you stay in, the more damage it does. It's even possible that...
possible that...
it's possible the memories we're digging into could eventually overwrite your own. Like information on a tape drive. There's just not enough space in your head to do both.
Here I come to save the day! Good afternoon, all.
Did you invite him?
No, but you did. Remember?
That was months ago, Warren. What do you need?
I wanted to stop by. Check on your progress.
Well, apparently it's still too dangerous to keep me under for more than a few minutes.
Hmm. I always suspected that would be your biggest hurdle. The genetic memory sequencing is the easy part, if time-consuming. But the replay, that's something else.
Yes?
Let's think this through. My subjects are diving into their own genetic memories, so the information is already encoded in their heads.
Which means the Animus has less work to do. Less computing, less parsing.
Right. So to get your surrogate data working, to let people experience foreign memories, it'll take a hell of a lot more processing power than anyone has. Even Abstergo Industries.
Ideally, we'd like to build an external processor that mirrors as many brain functions as possible. Something to handle the calculations.
But the cost and upkeep of that would be...
astronomical. Let me see what I can do. I have some sway with Lillian. We won't build Rome in a day. But if we focus on the pretty buildings first, maybe we'll achieve something.
Thank you, Warren.
Till next, folks.
Okay. Yep, tape recording ended there. So, we have hacked every computer! Mission success! Okay, and what we now need to do is... find the remaining sticky notes. How many are there left anyway? Sticky notes. 1, 2, 3, 1. Not so much, actually. Oh, wait. I will look up where they are. One. I found one. Number 12. Today's Abstergo's Templar forts have given themselves to base practice and claim wrongly that men and women are delicate and sensible and feeling creatures in and of themselves. And what the fuck just happened? Okay. And therefore deserves satiety and comfort and mindlessness in the presence of pleasure. Nothing could be sicker, falser, disgusting, lying bastards. Okay. Found another one all by myself. It was in the 7th and 18th century the world became an indecent place. Went of its original purpose during the ages of industrial revolutions. Here it was the machines of industry we unleashed in such grand quantities, quite without understanding them, unwound motives and purposes of their own, as inert as they were. Okay. For some reason there's another computer I can hack. And I don't know why. Is this a bug? Did I discover the bug? Or are you just screwing with me? Oh, I could have made that. No. I hate this. I hate this so much after a while. After a while, you start to hate little nice things you started to like because they felt original. Fuck it. Okay. Let's see. Is this actually a new thing?
Initial reports on Aveline de Grand Prix led us to believe she would be too controversial and impulsive to appeal to a wide audience. Teenaged memories show her brainwashed and trained to kill political foes of her highly unstable mentor, Agate. Additionally, Aveline spent a disappointing amount of time in the Louisiana Bayou, consorting with smugglers of the lowest kind.
Oh, I try never to think.
Which we felt risked her appeal to our female audience, which is now approaching 50%. However, as Aveline matured, a new side emerged. A well-mannered and considerate lady of poise and compassion, Aveline came to embrace a new mentor, her stepmother, Madeline Delisle, a tireless fighter for the rights of slaves.
Thank you, Madeleine.
With some editing to prioritize this relationship, we feel Aveline's story will more than meet our needs. Our team recommends a go on this property. Get this one to market quickly.
Sure, of course. Why? This... I mean... How... I hacked every computer and this is a file that just came up? They betrayed me! There are more computers than... Oh, high security camera. Then they actually showed me. Huh! Okay. Fine. After the last sticky note. Okay, this one I looked up. The new order is a disease, and Juno, may she guide us into the gray, will be our cure. Remember this. Remember that it was in the 18th century, slipping into the next, that the sickness took hold, and men began to believe they were a part, an individual of the original plan. Men shunned the plan, called us slaves when we were only fulfilling our duty. Wow. How the heck did I miss that one? This is as well one I looked up. 20. We submit ourselves to eternal servitude and service of a grander fulfillment. We submit the world to itself, it being a product that feeds life to life and death to death. May she, mother, sister, wife, lover, friend, bring light to darkened minds and humility to those who succor for its wisdom. Guide us into the gray, beloved. Guide us. Okay, there's one more to go. Alright, the last one. Manifesto of the Instrument of the First Will? Eh? Wait. Do I have all? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 13, 14, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20. It? What is this? Wait, do I really have all? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20. But then there are more than 20 notes. So there had to be one blank note. Yay, I did a challenge. Those are the first collectibles I ever completed in a game, I think. The only other collectibles are which I gain ability points or other stuff from it. Otherwise, I never bother for collectibles like that. And there's also a little bit more. There are messages I haven't read yet. Hey there, buddy pal. What's that? They've got your researching over there. Hush, hush. Top secret? Good for you. You Abstergo prodigy, you. At least they trust someone. Glad it's you. Finally, best wishes to Olivier. Everyone, let's all give Olivier and Abstergo Entertainment a big cheer as he heads off to Chicago for the shareholders meeting. We believe in you, Olivier. Support team, back to normal. So that's it? No explanation? We just keep going and hope nothing like that happens again? How can this even be legal? Oh well, another day, another dollar. Evan Dean Crybabies. Yo, that was seriously messed up. I agree. But come on. We get to make games. Isn't that worth a little weirdness sometimes? If you can't take the heat, get out of the kitchen. I understand we're all a little on edge. I hope you all take that coming long weekend to relax. Unwind, breath easy. Have a little fun when we get back. We have some major butt to kick. So I want you all bright and ready. John left? You know where John went? I got a bad feeling about this one. If you know something, you tell me, right? Or if you become one of them. Employee turnover. We all know this is a great place to work, but it's natural that people move on to pursue other interests. Let's keep the gossip to a minimum and focus on what's important. Great games. Well said. Diary?
face from the past. Oh! Much thanks for all your hard work, friend. We know it wasn't easy. Has been for us either. Losing Desmond was a terrible blow, and we've needed the past year just to get back on our feet. But we are standing and ready to jump. Everything you acquired here, everything you sent us, will be useful in some way. Don't wonder about that. So for now, keep your head down and your eyes on the task ahead. We may come calling soon. We hope you'll be ready. All the best, Bill. These strange notes contained the wavings of a weather fanatical individual. When arranged in the white sequence, they revealed a bizarre symbol of some kind. Religious, perhaps? Something else? Quests? And mission and quest. Oh! Small favor. Oh, those are all diaries, and all we did was... Oh, God. No active mission. Okay, so this is a diary about all what's been going on. You can see a map of the entire building. Okay. Is there anything else interesting? Oh. So I can look here if there's any more computers to hack. There's none left, and there's none left as well. I want to go to my files. Wait, what? Employee passport. Oh yeah, Abstergo Entertainment. Okay. Analyzers. There was one menu I didn't access. Oh, there it is. No active mission, return to Animus. Okay. So I think... Wait, controls? Okay. I go to sleep now. I don't end the episode here, but I'm going to sleep and continue in the morning. Maybe. Yeah. I think I do that. Yep. See you tomorrow in fresh shape and all. Okay, I'm gonna leave this video right here. I hope you enjoyed it, leave a like if you did, and I will hopefully see you in the final and concluding episode of Assassin's Creed Black Flag. Stay tuned.